Hachette Audio presents The Kill Chain, Defending America in the Future of High-Tech Warfare. Written and read by Christian Brose. For Molly. Introduction. Playing a losing game. One of the last conversations I ever had with John McCain in person was in the winter of 2017, shortly before he left Washington for the last time. We talked about how the United States could lose a war with China. Not in the distant future, but now. For most of the prior decade, I had been McCain's principal advisor on national security and military issues. During the last 4 years of his life, when he was chairman of the Senate Armed Services Committee, I was his staff director. That meant I led a team of defense policy experts who supported McCain and his colleagues in authorizing and overseeing the entire U.S. defense program, every policy and activity of the Department of Defense, every weapon it developed and bought, every dollar of the roughly $700 billion that it spent each year. McCain and I had access to the Pentagon's most highly classified secrets and programs, and we regularly met with our nation's top defense officials and highest-ranking military officers. That is what we had just finished doing on that winter day in 2017. McCain had directed me to set up a briefing for all 100 U.S. senators about the problem that had haunted us and motivated our work together for the past several years, the accelerating erosion of the U.S. military's technological advantage over other great powers, primarily China, which was rapidly building up arsenals of advanced weapons with the explicit purpose of being able to fight and win a war against the United States. McCain wanted his fellow senators to know that America was falling behind and at risk of losing a race that most of them did not even know was being run. For years, McCain and I had been pleading with Pentagon leaders to be clearer and more forthcoming with Congress and the American people about how bad things really were. They did not want to encourage our competitors by sounding defeatist, which was an apt concern, but it was a concern we had to overcome, because it is impossible to solve a problem that no one knows exists. As it stood, the Chinese Communist Party knew far more about the U.S. military and its vulnerabilities than the American people and their elected representatives did. That year, things seemed like they were starting to change. The chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff, General Joseph Dunford, had testified to McCain's committee in June. In just a few years, he said, if we do not change our trajectory, we will lose our qualitative and quantitative competitive advantage. In other words, the U.S. military would no longer be the best. A few months later, the RAND Corporation, a renowned nonpartisan research institute whose military analysis McCain and I consumed regularly, concluded in a major report that U.S. forces could, under plausible assumptions, lose the next war they are called upon to fight. That assessment was echoed by a bipartisan commission of military experts that McCain had established through legislation that year to provide an independent examination of U.S. defense strategy. They rendered their judgment to Congress shortly after McCain's death in 2018. America's military superiority has eroded to a dangerous degree, they wrote. The U.S. military could suffer unacceptably high casualties and loss of major capital assets in its next conflict. It might struggle to win, or perhaps lose, a war against China or Russia. McCain wanted the briefing that day to be a wake-up call to his colleagues, to provide many of the details behind these startling public pronouncements, and to build greater support for the new technologies, ideas, reforms, and resources that McCain and I had been trying for years to champion. All 99 of McCain's Senate colleagues were invited. About a dozen showed up. For those senators who were there, it was a depressing dose of reality. The person who provided the briefing that day was a former Pentagon official in the Obama administration named David Akmonik. A year later, he spoke publicly about the many war games, what are essentially simulations of future wars, that he has conducted for the Department of Defense upon leaving government. the U.S. military uses them to model actual campaigns against rival powers, in which each side fights with the military forces that it realistically expects to have in the near future. The opponent is always the red team, and the U.S. military is always the blue team. And this is how Akmanek described what has happened in those war games for years now. When we fight China or Russia, blue gets its ass handed to it. We lose a lot of people. We lose a lot of equipment. We usually fail to achieve our objective of preventing aggression by the adversary. Everyone assumes, based on 25 years of experience, that we have a dominant military establishment, that when we go to war, we always win, we win big, and there isn't any question about this. And when you say to people, "Not so fast," they're shocked because they've not had this experience. The truth is even worse than Akmanek describes. Over the past decade, in U.S. war games against China, the United States has a nearly perfect record. We have lost almost every single time. The American people do not know this. Most members of Congress do not know this, even though they should. But in the Department of Defense, this is a well-known fact. As McCain and I sat together at the end of the day, a pale winter twilight fading through the tall windows of his office in the Russell Building, he was clearly dejected. He slumped in his favorite antique chair and stared at the floor, his hands clasped together in front of his mouth. "How do you think it would go?" McCain asked. "A war against China, I mean." "Badly," I said. "No, really. How would it actually unfold?" What John McCain and I then proceeded to do, deep into that darkening evening, was imagine what would happen if the U.S. military was called upon to fight China in the next few years. We agreed that the United States would not start the war unprovoked, but that a war could start, nonetheless, for any number of reasons. It might start with an incident at sea between Chinese and American warships that kills sailors on both sides and then quickly escalates. It could start with a Chinese attack on a U.S. ally, to which Washington feels obligated to respond. But no matter why a war might start, McCain and I saw it unfolding from there in much the same way. Many of the U.S. ships, submarines, fighter jets, bomber aircraft, additional munitions, and other systems that are needed to fight would not be near the war when it started, but would be thousands of miles away in the United States. They would come under immediate attack once they began their multi-week mobilization across the planet. Cyber attacks would grind down the logistical movement of U.S. forces into combat. The defenseless cargo ships and aircraft that would ferry much of that force across the Pacific would be attacked every step of the way. Satellites on which U.S. forces depend for intelligence, communications, and global positioning would be blinded by lasers, shut down by high-energy jammers, or shot out of orbit altogether by anti-satellite missiles. The command and control networks that manage the flow of critical information to U.S. forces in combat would be broken apart and shattered by electronic attacks, cyber attacks, and missiles. Many U.S. forces would be rendered deaf, dumb, and blind. While these attacks were underway, America's forward bases in places like Japan and Guam would be inundated with waves of precise ballistic and cruise missiles. The few defenses those bases have would quickly be overwhelmed by the sheer volume of weapons coming at them, with many leaking through. Those bases would have no defense against China's hypersonic weapons, which can maneuver unpredictably, fly at 5 times the speed of sound, and strike their targets within minutes of being launched. As all of these missiles slammed into U.S. bases, they would destroy fighter jets and other aircraft on the ground before U.S. pilots could even get them airborne. They would crater runways, blow up operations centers and fuel storage tanks, and render those U.S. forward bases inoperable. If any aircraft did manage to escape the Chinese missiles, it would be forced to relocate to another base in the region, which itself would come under attack. It would look like a U.S. evacuation. In the early days of a war with China, many of the forces located at these forward bases would not even be in the fight. Older, non-stealthy fighter jets such as F-15s and F-16s, would not play an offensive role because they could not survive against China's advanced fighters and surface-to-air missile systems. The same is true of the Navy's F-18s. The limited numbers of stealthy fifth-generation fighter jets that could be brought to bear, such as F-22s and F-35s, can fly only several hundred miles on a single tank of fuel, so they would depend heavily on aerial refueling tankers to be able to reach their targets.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.